Jay Shrek, I tell you what, you might think I'm a masked outlaw, and you'd be half right. But right now, what I'm going into is we're going back in time today. We're going back to 1855, and we are going to a town that's been recreated in Missouri. The incredible thing about this town is that this whole area has seen the Civil War, seen all kinds of battles. This is basically the area where all the trails started, the Santa Fe Trail, the Oregon Trail, the California Trail. And so this was a hotbed of activity for years. All the immigrants traveled through here to get to the West and the West Coast and the Southwest. And so what they've done is they've recreated an area that looks like it would be if you step back in time into 1855. Now look at these houses right here. Isn't that incredible? Look at that. Very, very unbelievable that they recreated this entire town to show you what life would be like if you traveled back into time to 1855. You know, in 1855, this area was a hotbed of activity, especially as we talk about the battles that were really raving on at that time. You know, one of the difficult things about living in that time was, you know, the border wars that were going on, you know. And so this would have been not only a difficult time to live in just because of the how tough it would have been just to survive back in this time, but again, the politics that raved on at this time. Look at that incredible building right there. You know, it's not that small. I mean, you know, living in a place like this at this level, I mean, seriously, in the age of tiny houses and people realizing that they don't need a lot anymore. I mean, I could see this being more than sufficient on what you need. You know, two rooms. I mean, it'd be nice to have more like always, but you know what the reality of it is.
We'll hold them out, but if you don't have slats, it's very easy to just sew some cording in there, and then when you starch it, it helps to hold it out. Now, I fold mine back because I don't like it sticking way out over my face. Working with animals, you have to be able to see them.
Right.
If you don't see the animals, you could be in danger.
Exactly. Sure. Do you get really hot?
Yeah, don't you?
I'm very hot right now.
But so. I'll tell you what, the being out in the sun with all of this on, it keeps my skin from getting direct sunlight, and that does help.
Thanks for sharing. You know, we're in Missouri City, and I'm here with Angela, who's going to tell us a little bit more about the location that we're at right now.
Right now in Missouri Town, all of the buildings that are here have been brought from about a 7-county region within Missouri to preserve the architecture. The one that we're in right now is called the Tavern. It was originally built about 1822, and in 1839, Judge Thomas Chavez purchased it, turned it into a tavern because there were 3 stagecoaches going by every week. So people had traveled for a day, they needed a place to eat and sleep, and then they had another day yet to travel. So if you want to look at the rooms upstairs, You'll notice that there's one room for women and children, one room for men. The men's room is currently unfinished on the walls, and that's only so you can see the simplicity of how it is built.
So this is actual this is actual building that was transported here.
From here to here. This one was located at Berry City, which is now in North Kansas City, around 120 or I-29 and Berry Road. Stagecoach Road is the road that it was actually located on.
That's excellent. So you were saying that the building is split up between men and women.
Yes.
And would the children go with the men or would the children go with the women?
The children would stay in the room with the women.
Okay. This is excellent that they would put. So most of the buildings here have been located from other locations.
Yes.
To build Missouri Town out of what they could save around the state, basically.
Right. Okay. Because otherwise these buildings would be gone and the history that is
right.
with them would be gone.
That's excellent.
Just be those.
Yeah, there should
go. Oh, I'm fine. Us men had to know how to do this stuff. That's why. Now, this area here would have been the men's area right here. So they basically separated them out. Now this was a working tavern. It was also an area where you get off the stagecoaches and you'd rest. And so this would be the men's area. And then again, over here would be the women's. It's so incredible that these buildings still stand. So if you see that the women's area is finished out, now, if we go over here, the men's is not. And it's not because they didn't want to finish the men's out. They just wanted to show you how the construction was in this room. And this is really an incredible place. Really unbelievable. The construction and the beams of all this. And the fact that they have taken these buildings from all kinds of different locations throughout Missouri where they would have been lost. And just like the ruins of the Southwest, it's so nice to be able to preserve this stuff, and that's why we work so hard on trying to make sure that even the ancient ruins that we have are preserved. Thank you very much. You've been awesome. You know, as we talked about going the different characters, and you know, one thing we don't do is we don't judge any of them. You know, history will judge itself. I don't need to be the judge of history. All I do is look at history because I wasn't born in this era. I have no idea what it was like to live in this era. I mean, I can kind of get a thought process, but you know, I don't know. Now, this was one of the Daltons' buildings right here, the famous Daltons that you hear about. Now, Quantrell was visiting this location and very narrowly escaped this facility. So he was in this exact building. Isn't that incredible? And thank goodness that there are places around that have saved this. You know, we go back, we've got to save our history. And it isn't about the good history and the bad history, it's just the history. And it will repeat itself. But can you imagine that, you know, Quantrell, for all his terrible deeds, still stepped foot and narrowly escaped the Federals in this house. Isn't that incredible? I tell you what, it's just to me, it's incredible. I love this and I love the history. You know, one thing about it is, you know, now that I'm from the Southwest, and people might ask, well, what's it like heat-wise? Well, it's actually, to me, with the humidity, it's actually a lot hotter out here than it is anywhere else. I mean, even back in the non-humidity of 105 day in Phoenix, Arizona, I remember how you just kind of soak in this, but it's so phenomenal that they would have spent the time to do this, put this together so that we would remember the history. And I find it just fascinating that these areas still exist. And they, you know, look at these steps that they built, chiseled out.
Look at this building. This would have been the church. There's the pulpit. You know, they'd had to do a lot of work here to keep the people from sinning. This was the Flint Rock Church. It was a Baptist church, and this stood 5.5 miles north of Platte City. They believe that this building was built in 1848. But it might be as new as 1850 or 53. Andrew Johnson patented the property where the Flintlock Church was originally located in 1840. And he donated the land for the church in 1844. Captain Johnson was elected as Platte County's first state senator in 1842. Wow. How incredible is this? Tell you what, this has been a fascinating journey through here. Now, what we're going to do is take a look at one of the most famous things that come out of Missouri. You might have thought that was me. Well, it ain't. It's this guy right here. It's this mule. Now, it looks like a horse, right? He looks like a horse. But the reality of it is, it's a mule. Now, in Missouri, they use larger mules because they would be on the plains and they would be doing all kinds of different activities with these mules, where the smaller mules were better equipped to do work in, say, Mexico, where they were going up, climbing up areas and up mountains, things like that, where these would be more working stock. Look at that guy. Isn't he handsome? That's Jack the Mule. Could be, say, maybe Jackass, is that might be what it is. Did Morgan pet you? Huh? Did Morgan pet you?
No. I didn't know if we were supposed to.
Look. Look at that. So let's go in here. So that is exactly. Do not feed them. Look how big that guy is. Look how many hands that mule is. So that's where Missouri was famous for its mules, right there. And look how big that guy is. A lot of people think that's a horse. It's not. That is a mule. And his name is Jack. We've been roaming around the whole deal, and we've come across some people that are out here that have a lot more knowledge than I do. And we're going to talk to Tim about oxen, believe it or not. Here's Tim right here.
How are you? So oxen are basically cows that have been pulled out from outside of the food chain. Normally you would eat steers like them. You would process them to have beef to eat, but these two have been pulled out of the food chain and are set aside to train to become oxen. And oxen are trained for 3 years. They're trained to work under a yoke to provide you with a power supply in order to clear and plow your fields and provide the ability to grow your crops or your cash crops like corn and hemp and those types. You would use oxen to pull the stones out, to pull the stumps out, and to clear your field so that then you could plow it with either the oxen or mule stock.
I had no idea that oxen were just basically, they were trained to be oxen.
Exactly.
I had no idea. That is fascinating to me.
It's an average about 3 years to train them, and they start when they're very young. So as soon as they're weaned, basically they go to school. They start going to school. And they're one of the biggest challenges for the people that train them is to get them very young so that they get used to having something behind them. Most of the time, if you think about a cow, the only thing that's going to be behind the cow that's making noise is going to be something that wants to eat them.
Right.
So for them to get used to hearing the noise of equipment behind them, they'll actually drag what's called a stone boat. We have one inside the barn there you can go look at. But they drag it up and down this road here. They started with a car tire because the stone boat was too heavy. And they have different sizes of yokes in there that you can see that basically tie them together as a team. And then you could decide which side the one's going to be on. He's always going to be either left or right side. You'll never be able to take the left ox and put him on the right side. He won't pull. They get used to the side they're on, and that's the side they work for the rest of their life.
Now, if I was coming here, I got off the riverboat, and I wanted to go west.
Mm-hmm.
So I would buy these oxen. I would choose an oxen. Would that be the
You could purchase oxen, or you could purchase mules, or you could purchase horses. It would depend on your preference. It would also depend on the recommendations made by whoever's helping you take your journey.
Right.
Most people that got stock in order to go west, they got green stock, which means they were not trained.
Right.
They were untrained stock. So the some of the documentation out of Independence that some gentlemen that were basically had created a business to go west and become wealthy, they came to Independence. They outfitted their organization in teams. They bought all the equipment, and then they purchased livestock, and they had to go 30 miles south from Independence to pick up the livestock. They had to be trained on the way. So one of the biggest problems they had was when people got livestock that wasn't trained, they didn't know how to train them. And so a lot of times they'd let them out, or they'd tie them to a tree or something, a small tree, for them to feed overnight. When they get up in the morning, their stock are gone because they just basically pull off whatever rope they're on and they take off and run off. And so then you have to spend a couple of days hunting down your animals and then hope you can recover them or go back and get more. So now, it was very hard to do.
Now tell us a little bit, if you can, about Jack over there. Jack is the mule.
Yep. Jack the mule, he just came in this last winter, basically. He's about 16 to 20 years old, according to the livestock lady that works out here. Her name is Linda, and she takes care of all the livestock. But Jack came out, his daddy was what they call a mammoth Jack, which is an extremely large donkey. The mammoth Jack was pretty commonly used for breeding in Missouri mules because they are extremely large. And then his mother was a draft horse, what's called a Percheron breed. And she was very large herself because Percherons are very large horses. They're draft stock.
So okay.
He's considered a draft mule. And he's one of the biggest mules I've ever seen because of that stock, those two oversized stock breeds that he was bred from. So now a mule has a short mane like the donkey, they have the round nose like a donkey, and they have the elongated ears like a donkey. They also tend to have a narrower hoof print than a horse does of the same size. So the ideal thing there is they're very sure-footed, but they take up less of the space in your field when you're plowing. They're less likely to tromp down what they've already plowed up. So if you're planting, if you're using them with a planter behind them, they're less likely to stomp down what you planted in the row before because they're a little narrower in their stride.
So that's incredible.
It is amazing to learn about them.
So Missouri, you know, you think about mules, Missouri mule, right?
Yeah.
I mean, the reason was the breeding of the quality of the mules here.
Yeah, they were using the larger stock equine. The horse stock, the draft stock, and those quarter horses, things that were larger, they wanted to breed into them the characteristics they desired the most. And so they were using that larger mules or larger donkey to get the larger mules for draft purposes.
That's fascinating.
So when you look at the Santa Fe Trail, for instance, the wagon alone to go on the Santa Fe Trail, if you're a freight driver, your wagon all by itself is 4,000 pounds right off the top. You've got to have animals that can pull that 4,000 pounds. You haven't even loaded that thing yet. So if you look over at the corner of this building that's a blacksmith shop, right below one of the windows is a very large iron tire that was the front tire of a freight wagon, or at least close to that size that would have been a freight wagon tire. And the front, now the back was even bigger. But once you've got those loaded, the box on that wagon is a little more than 6 foot deep, and there's not much room in there after you've loaded it completely. Mm-hmm. The reason they use such large wagons is the president of Mexico charged a toll for every wagon that came into Santa Fe. And so to reduce the amount of money you lost on the investment of going down there, you just increase the size of your wagon twofold or threefold. Then you're only paying one toll to go into the town, as opposed to three or four.
I didn't realize there were 4,000 pounds.
Yeah, 4,000 pounds in lumber. So then when you get down there, then you have options. You've already got a pretty much got a contract on the goods you're hauling down. They're also buying your empty bottles, because they don't have a glass factory down there, so they're willing to buy empty bottles for twice what you paid for the full bottle. They'll pay for the empty. The other thing, you can take that lumber that was your wagon, because you've just knocked all the tires and wheels out from under it, dragging it all the way down to Santa Fe with these thousands of pounds of freight in it. You can then take that lumber that's left, and you can break that down into raw lumber, and you can sell that off as lumber for building materials. Wow. And so then you come back with your livestock and maybe a wagon or two. You come back and you've doubled your money, at least doubled your money as you went down there. So when you get back, you just turn around and do the whole thing over again. So it was very lucrative business.
That's incredible.
Material similar to what they used in the period. This is called tin plate. It's a steel sheet with a tin coating on each side. This is done by taking a sheet of steel, dipping it in an acid bath for a period of time, taking it out of there, rinsing it, and dipping it in molten tin. And when it draws through, a pair of rollers coming out of that tin, it evens out the surface of the tin coating. And that gives you a more level playing field, so you don't have hard spots and soft spots in your sheet. So you get a more even bending process. And you start out with this. It's a 14 by 10 and a quarter inch sheet. That's the average size of the sheet of tin in those days. And you started out with that, and you worked from patterns. The patterns were usually passed on from each generation of tinsmith to the next generation of tinsmiths. And they'd work those patterns. They would scribe out all the pieces, cut them out. The apprentices would spend all day, if they weren't sweeping, they were making out all of these patterns, scribing out and then cutting all the pieces so that the journeyman tinsmith could then form those into working material. And if you need extremely large items, you then take those sheets and seam them together and combine the number of sheets to make whatever size object you need. So this is a reflector oven, and this is the majority of, each side has the majority of one sheet here, a sheet here, and then both of, or all four of these side pieces would basically equate to a sheet.
Mm-hmm.
And then the handles, and then some of the small pieces, those would come off of whatever was left over from something, either this or something else. So,
in the period, so every town would have a tinsmith.
They wouldn't necessarily have a tinsmith. They'd always have a blacksmith somewhere close.
Okay.
But tinsmiths weren't, they weren't prolific.
Okay.
And so some towns had six, maybe as many as three, in the bigger towns, three
right.
to six. Some towns wouldn't have one at all
right.
until well into the 1890s.
Right. Okay. Okay.
But yeah, the thing about it though was there was always tinware coming up the river on the boats from
okay.
St. Louis.
Okay.
St. Louis provided most of all the tinware for the Western United States that was dropped. It was basically picked up at St. Louis and then brought up in the river boats and then dispersed throughout the area.
Okay. Tell you what, this is just, it's a fascinating place. I mean, if you're into history, this is some place you need to come stop by. You know, we've missed a lot of museums that we normally would go through that, you know, we got five or six museums that we wanted to hunt down that we're not going to be able to get into because of what's going on. But you know what? There's still places open. You know, we've got this entire place to ourselves. So make sure you come support this if you're in town, you're in the area, that you come around here and take a look at this place. You know, one of the most important facilities in any western, eastern town would have been the blacksmith shop. You know, we've seen the blacksmith shops all over, and you know, they would have made all the stuff that was necessary on the trail. And take a look. How incredible is this? Really incredible. I tell you what, it's just fascinating that that somebody sees that history is valuable, the value of history, that we haven't lost that. You know, there's DiBello right there, stoked the fire. Wow. So these two guys here are being trained to be oxen. I didn't realize that they actually got trained. I had no idea. So if you needed stumps pulled, or you needed an animal that was gonna be able to do the deal and take the punishment and take the heat, these were your guys right here. Unbelievable. They're in training, see? How good looking are these two?
One over here is Studebaker.
Studebaker.
And that's Weber. And they are named after wagon makers.
Cool. So Studebaker was a wagon maker before a car. I'm
Absolutely.
Just guessing.
Yes,
you know, it all lays out history-wise, doesn't it?
No.
We're going to walk up to the old house up here. It is closed up, but I want to take a look and see what it looks like, you know, because all these structures were taken and removed, you know, and moved to this location, and which is pretty incredible when you really think about, you know, that all these areas were saved. You know, it was a tough, tough life. And, you know, especially when you had all the different sanctions going on in the, all the different areas where life was difficult enough as it was, but then all of a sudden you have a lot of different stuff going on. Something we all need. Unbelievable. I'll tell you what, it's an incredible place to be, incredible place to get to visit. And you know, you find the passion of these people doing what they do. You know, we all have the passion. That old barn, how cool is that? Is that a... I don't... I think it's a hedgehog. It looks like a beaver, but he doesn't have a beaver tail. Oh, he's jacked up. Whatever's wrong with him, he's got something. He got into something. A wagon sitting there, these old barns. You know, I am completely drenched. You know, my daughter was talking about, you know, and we're from Phoenix, okay? So this is the craziest. How did they survive? Well, you know, you had to survive. We didn't have much of an option. But look at me, I'm drenched. This humidity is so much different than what I've gotten used to, or the dry heat. But I tell you what, this is one of the most beautiful places I mean, I could see somebody coming here and wanting to have something of this level of how beautiful this is. I mean, this is just, I mean, this is another level. You know, take somebody you know out. You know, we used to do a thing we used to call History Sunday, where we would go out and see places as a family. And you know, it ain't about whether the guy was good or the guy was bad. It's about history. History is what it is, you know, and there's good and there's bad. And if you learn from it, what's up with that? Don't be afraid of your past. Cherish it. Well, it was even bad. I mean, it is what it is. That doesn't mean it's you. If you don't like what your ancestors did, then change it, you know. You know, if you don't like what happened to your ancestors, make a difference today. You know, what are you doing for the people that you know? What are you doing for your family? And that's what I look at, not what's there. Let's take a look through this window right here. What you got right here is a school. Look how tough that would have been. Well, I think we talked about they survived because they had to. So here we are, getting ready to leave 1855 town, getting the air conditioner, and if you get a chance, it's in Lake Jacomo, which is outside of Blue Springs and Lee's Summit. Beautiful park, huge, absolutely huge. They got bison that roams. Incredible place. So if you get a chance to come down here, please do so. Jay Schreck, Black Flag Expeditions with Moogie. There's Moogie right there. Moogie. There's Moogie. Is that your truck, Moogie, right there?
I wish I had that.
Well, it wouldn't take a lot to make it yours.
I could probably buy it.